If you're ready to walk in authority, help finding your purpose and destiny, empowering you to live today.
Praise God, friends. It's so good to be with you today. We're always excited to share the Word of God with you. I believe that we're living in very exciting times and seasons. I believe these days and times in which we're living, God is pouring out His Spirit like never before, as prophesied. And God is always a God of His Word. The Word of God declares in Mark chapter 16 and verse 15, "And He said unto them, Go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They shall cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover." Verse 19 is so crucial in 20. "So then, after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. And they went forth preaching everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs and wonders following." I believe that it is God's desire that signs and wonders would follow us as we work the word and co-labor with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Remember, all good and all perfect gifts comes down from the Father above, with whom there's no variableness, neither shadow of turning. And so therefore, if there's any gift to be given, if there's any glory to be given, it belongs to the Lord. For he, I trust that you will be blessed by the sharing of this testimony from a family in one of our sister churches located in Corona, California, as they give their testimony here at our Mother Church in Rancho Cucamonga, California. Please join us.
Okay. Good morning, Lifeway.
Good morning.
I'm Deacon Todd from Lifeway of Corona. This is my lovely family, Sonia, my son Cameron, and my daughter Taylor. We have two other ones that are at school. You want to start with it?
Stomp on the devil's head.
We
are, he is up under our feet. I'm here today to tell you that God is good.
Amen.
I praise him today, yesterday, and the day before. I praise him now.
Yeah.
I'd like to first say to everyone that my son Cameron was not with us on Monday, January 21st. He is a diabetic type 1. There is no cure for this. So he depends on insulin for his life. I am a trained medical nurse. I am a licensed nurse. And on this morning at 2:42 in the morning, my husband who sleeps hard as a rock, can't wake him up for nothing. I was asleep that night, that morning. We had all gone to bed and everything was wonderful. We had prayed and God was good. We had miracle
Sunday
service.
We had a healing service.
We had a healing service, a healing service.
Cameron went up.
He was he went up with another sister from Lifeway of Corona, Sister Camille. And whatever she saw in him, she said, "Can I stand in the gap?" She
Amen.
Took Cameron up as Pastor Stingley began to pray. Cameron fell back in unison with Sister Camille in the anointing.
Amen.
He said he never felt such a peace. I'm not going to speak for Cameron because Cameron has something that he would like to say later on. But just to give you the story that he doesn't remember, he only remembers just a small part of it, just a very small part of it. But everyone here on the stage was in unison on this morning. So my husband hears something. He says, "Babe, do you hear that?" I said, "No, I don't hear nothing." "What, Todd?" So he sat on the edge of the bed, and all of a sudden he jumps and he runs down our bedroom. He goes to the right, down the hall, into Cameron's room. And I hear my husband yell out. He yells out, "No, you will not take my son. You will not take my son in the name of Jesus." My son is not a small boy. Neither is my husband. My husband took this boy dragged him down the hallway and he called out, "Sonia, 911, Cameron's down." I, as a nurse, did not see Cameron at this time. I ran down the stairs. God put us in place. He told Todd, Deacon Todd, "You do this. Taylor, I want you to do this. Sonia, you go get the insulin. You go get the supplies that you're going to need to bring this boy back." When I got to Cameron and I went up to those stairs, Taylor sat there and she was very calm. Now let me share this with you. A week prior to Cameron going into Low Sugars, God had given Taylor a dream, and he told her that her brother was going to fall, and he was going to go fall out from his diabetes. So Taylor said, God told her, pray. This was a week prior. I said, okay, Taylor, we're going to pray. And I thank God for this, because this was the introduction of what was to come. So
Not only that, but the bishop had taught a couple of weeks ago about being in alignment with the Lord. Amen. And when you're not in alignment, it's the enemy has access to get into you. When I arrived in the room, my son was bent over, laid out on the floor. Like, "Cameron, wake up, Lord Jesus." And I'm looking at him. I'm like, you can literally see the enemy taking him. And I'm binding that devil off of him in Jesus' name. "You're not taking this one, not this morning. We ain't having that this morning. You ain't having that." No, I'm lifting him over. His arms is just like lump. Normally when Cameron goes into Lord's sugar, he's trying to fight everybody. This kid was just laid. I'm hollering out, Sonia.
So with that being said, and as my husband described, because I didn't see that part, my son is he's a big boy, and he has a captain's bed. And surrounding that captain's bed is marble. Now, when my husband found my son, and all this came to me as the week went by, that Cameron didn't lay accidentally on his left side. That God allowed the angels to lay him properly, not face down where he could have suffocated. Because when my husband walked in, my son was what they call in medical terms, and I know we have some nurses and some doctors out here maybe, he was chain stoken. I worked hospice.
His
I seen
breath.
Him. He was going through his last breath. So he was... So my husband drug him out. He had had the seizure, and I knew he had had the seizure because his body was limp. He was sweat. That when I pulled the sweater, the shirt off of his body, it was drenched in sweat, and I could just wring it out. And I don't mean to embarrass you, but he had urinated all over himself. My husband drug him out. I dropped to my knees in front of my son. At that minute, as a medical nurse, I knew. I checked his pulse. I could not feel a pulse.
Nothing.
I checked the carotid. I could not feel it. It was faint. My son's eyes was fixated in the back of his head, and I called out as a wailing mother in Jerusalem, Father God, in the name of your son, Jesus, bring my son back. Bring my baby back, Father God. You are good. God is good, and I'm here to tell you because you see him standing here. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
As I'm praying for my son, let me tell you how the enemy works. This girl, my daughter, my eldest daughter, calm as can be, because she already knew what was going to happen. She sits on the phone with the 911 operator. And the 911 operator says, "Hi, this is 911, such and such. What is your medical call?" She says, "My brother, he's insulin dependent. He's down. He's out." She hears me hollering in the back, so the enemy intercedes what she needs to be doing because it's a three-minute response for the ambulance and the paramedic to arrive. She's telling her, What is she yelling? You tell her to stop, calm down. I yelled back at her and I said, you shut up in the name of Jesus. I am pleading the blood of Jesus over my son. My daughter tells her, now the enemy is intervening. He's trying to stop.
Yes, he was.
She comes in and she says, listen to my voice very calmly. She says, I live in Corona, California. We need medical response now.
Amen.
As I still pray over my son, he then, my husband, goes and makes a phone call.
I saw that I couldn't get him. So because of the alignment I was taught from the bishop, you have to line yourself up. And you really have to line yourself up, because when the enemy see you confused and lost, that's when he strikes you, and he strikes hard. And because I'm young and we're young in Christ, my first call was my pastor,
Stingley.
Now, that's my pastor. This is my bishop. Amen. This is how God works. Amen. Because of the anointing he has over us, our bishop, I was calling the cleaners. Literally. Got no response. My next call was not hesitated. Boom. The bishop hit him, told him, cameras down, one call.
Now, let me say this. Pastor Stingley was not available for a purpose.
Everything,
but let me tell you, when my husband called Bishop Chris, he picked up in two rings as if he was already awake.
Ready.
As God has already had him ready to do what he needed to do. And I thank you, Father.
You guys got to realize.
I thank you, Father.
You guys got to realize.
He had everybody positioned.
This wasn't a fight for a deacon or a minister. See, I didn't call a minister.
No.
I didn't call one of my deacons.
God knew who he wanted.
You got a lifeline. We all got one. You better use it and get it right. Because you got one lifeline. I called out everything. Lord, help me, help me. At that time, I called my bishop. He picked it up. One call said, my boy is down. Cameron is down. He went right into it. I threw my phone on speaker, and my boy laid there dead. Literally. I'm still looking for the paramedics. Now, 3 minutes has had to go by. I called my bishop. I put the phone. I said, Cameron is down. He's under. Boom. Because he knows us and he knows the awareness of all of us, I hope, because he knows my family and our illness, because he has to pray for each and every one of us. I put the phone up to his ear, and all I heard was, release my boy. And he went into a battle that I couldn't handle. My wife couldn't handle. The paramedics
Praise
couldn't
God.
Handle.
God gave it to God gave it to Bishop Chris, because he was the one that God wanted to intercede and intervene at that time.
I needed a bishop, not a pastor. Do you hear what I'm saying? He's your pastor. He's my bishop. I couldn't use a minister because this was battle time. When God tell you to have your armor on, like Denzel was singing, we wasn't at practice. We was in battle. That's when you gotta set aside your pride, right? You gotta set aside your pride. And I called this bishop, it was one call. Picked it up, and I didn't have to go into details. He was already under the anointing.
As if he knew.
Already prepared himself through the shut-in. And was already, because of the prayers was there, went in and he called him out. Release my boy. He didn't call him by his name. He said his boy.
Yes, he did.
Release
him.
And I'm
pulling
out of him. Get away from him. That's what he was on my phone. I gave the phone to my daughter. I then ran downstairs in the middle of the street. I'm like, Lord, where's the paramedics? Like, Lord, where are they at?
So as Cameron laid there, and as a mother, Todd is gone at this point. Now it's me, Taylor, and Cameron, and the presence of the Lord. God was there. I have no doubt that God was there. I have no doubt that the angels was fighting against the enemy. I have no doubt. I have no doubt. But I tell you, as I laid there as a mother on my knees, I'm a big girl, but I dropped to my knees and I cradled my baby and I prayed over him as Bishop Chris was on the other line, praying over him,
praying,
fighting.
Get away from him.
I stopped praying. I stopped because I heard Bishop Chris say, bring him back in the name of Jesus.
Bring him back. He hollered it with authority.
Now, I'm doing all that I can. I administer the glucagon.
It didn't work.
As a nurse, and they tell you, you never, never stick your fingers in a person's mouth if they're seasoned or because they can bite down on you. I didn't care. I took that honey and I merged it into my baby's gums because when you apply it into the gums and the membranes, it's supposed to soak in. Nothing was working because God was already doing his work.
Amen.
Nothing was working. This boy is a living miracle. Then, as I'm sitting there and I'm crying, I look over at my daughter, but she's at peace. As if she already knows she's at peace, but she's letting me go through my thing. She's letting him go through his thing. And Cameron's laying there. He begins to now vomit and seize a little bit more. And his eyes is behind his head. He's not responding. I lift his arm up. I can't. His limp. It falls down. His body is just immersed in urine and other things. But my baby was not here. He was not here.
The whole time, somehow, we got disconnected through the bishop for a moment. And I had
the enemy.
The enemy. But because we have a strong bishop.
Yeah. Praise God.
And when you align yourself up, alignment is everything. Yeah. Because I was so obedient and disciplined, he never stopped praying for him. Yeah. When I picked the phone up, I said, the bishop, he was still going at it, fighting the enemy. Let me remind you, the enemy is sneaky, and we can't fight him. We can fight to a certain extent, but when you got one lifeline, you don't have time to play around. You got to call people that's going to get down for you. And I mean get down. He never stopped what he was doing because that was his job. He's obedient. So when he tells you to do something, do it. Because you never know when you're going to call on your bishop to come and fight for you. And when he came and fought, the enemy couldn't stand it. He hated it because he knew I had a higher calling. And I knew who to call. I knew who was going to fight and win my battle. When they see Bishop coming, they know. And I put this on everything.
Yes.
He called him out. When he called him out, releasing my boy, literally. The paramedics ain't even here.
There ain't no paramedics.
Where they at?
No paramedics.
Because God intervened.
But nothing there but the presence of God. And as Cameron, as I stopped and Bishop Chris said, release him now. Come back, Cameron. Bring my boy back in the name of Jesus. My son, who was breathing.
Barely.
He began to breathe like this. And it was not anything but the grace of God that brought my son back to life. My baby came back to life in the name of Jesus. He came back. I praise God. I thank you, Father. God is a good God. He is a merciful God. I thank you, Jesus. My baby don't remember nothing, but let me tell you, as a medical nurse, this boy did. We don't know how long he was out.
I don't know how long he laid in that room.
I don't know how long he was there, but let me tell you, he's standing here.
Amen.
He's okay. He had nothing wrong with his brain. No broken bones. His liver is good.
Let me tell you, everything is good
in the name of Jesus.
Let me tell you. We don't know how long Cameron laid on that floor. But as a parent, my baby, you gotta be on point. Paramedics still ain't made it. At this point, I left it because at that point, God revealed to me it wasn't a job for the paramedics.
They got there.
Because the paramedics
got there 7 minutes late.
They can only heal you with a cut. I needed somebody that can go to the spirit and bring it. I needed somebody that can dig down. When I laid and I was praying, I prayed. I did every prayer that I know. Lord, release not my boy, not.
So when the paramedics get there, and I just want to tell the end of the story. When the paramedics get there, They come in like la-di-da.
Nonchalant, talking about the stretcher. We're the stretcher.
It wasn't nothing but God.
They walked around confused.
He had already done the work. He had already done the work, so they just coming in la-di-da.
And the reason for it, because the bishop was already in it, in anointing, working
already,
and fixing his head. Because I tell you, I didn't want him to come back a vegetable. I don't know how long he laid. He had no oxygen to the head. And the first thing I'm thinking, football, I don't want him back like a vegetable.
So the paramedics then proceed to go ahead and they can't get an IV in this arm. So I'm looking. I said, well, heck, I could do it.
Nonchalant.
Then they go ahead and they put one in this arm here. They finally get it. They administer the dextro 5% and push 20 mLs of sugar into the IV line.
While we're still praying.
And
only one paramedic
understood
what was going on.
It was okay because God had already done his work. He had already done his
work. Only one paramedic kneeled by him. And I'm watching the whole situation because I'm getting upset. I'm looking down my street. You ain't even came, but I'm understanding. I thank God for teaching me how to be humble and be patient and let our man of God do his job. When we call on him,
yes,
he's always there. Never a minute late. Never saying, I'm still asleep. I'm still asleep, Todd. Call me tomorrow. It wasn't that. He went in the battle and he had his armor on. And I had to understand that because we put the puzzles together. It was meant for them idiots to be late because what they had to repair.
They did their part.
They did
their job, but later.
They couldn't touch him here. That was through the bishop who called it off and continued to repair him the way he left. Repair
through
all
the grace
of
God. Through the grace of God.
Stronger and better, and he's so knowledgeable now. Not that he was before. But see, he had to pray, the bishop, to prepare what
God
man couldn't
was going
prepare
to do
up here.
And what God is going
and
to
fix
do.
Fix him all the way back down. And when he came through, God is so good.
Now,
God is good.
God is grace. Now, I want you to hear the whole story because I want you to understand how good God is and why we have to serve in his kingdom, why we have to be in alignment, why we have to be obedient, why we have to tithe, why we have to follow
Lord.
Directions and do the things that we don't want to do all the time, but you need
Amen.
To do.
Yeah.
Because when God tells you to do it through word of bishop, then you need to do it. Because you never know when you're going to need him. When you're going to need him. And then for you to turn your back when he asks you just to do a little something. Clean the carpet. It's okay. Hey. But I'm trying to tell you that when the paramedics finally came in and they got this boy up, they says, okay, we're going to take him to the hospital.
No, they asked,
did you want to go? He said to Cameron, can you stand? He said, yes, I can.
On his own
he
two feet.
He stood up on 2 feet. He walked down 12 steps of stairs.
Tell him what his sugars was when he was under.
When they brought him back, they're looking. They can't get a blood pressure, but they see he has a slight heart rhythm. Now he got a heart rhythm because they was late anyways. God had already done his work. So he got a slight heart rhythm. So they says to Cameron, boy, let me check your blood sugars. For a diabetic, a normal blood sugar should be between, some doctors vary, but I'm going to say 80 to 180. That's a pretty good blood sugar. This boy was below 20. Done. But God said, no, he ain't.
God got plans.
No, I got some plans for this child. I got plans for this child. I'm crying and I'm well and I'm thanking you, Father.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
The paramedics is looking at me like I'm crazy,
thank
but
you,
I said,
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus.
Glorify you.
No one thing.
This boy, x-ray, CT scans of the head.
Completely,
they did blood work.
Jesus
oh, he's fine.
Yeah.
Released within 2-3 hours from
Amen.
The hospital.
Hey. Let me tell them this. That can only work when you align yourself up, though. That's so important, and I keep telling you that, because had my family not been aligned up behind the bishop, and had he not taught on it the week before, we would have been doing this, walking all crazy up in the house while the boy's sitting down there dying. Because of the teaching and the education that our bishop has taught us, align yourself up and be obedient. And the house, when you humble yourself and take care of the house, when you take care of the house, he
your
will
kingdom.
Take care of
take
your
care
house.
Of the kingdom.
And this is living proof. I thank God every day my family is blessed and strong. And we ain't going nowhere. We ain't going nowhere today, tomorrow, or anytime. We're going to serve the house Because God has told me, I work in the kingdom, he going to take care of mine. And it ain't no other way. Stay blessed. So Bishop, wait, I thank you.
Hold on. Oh, yeah. Go ahead. Hold on. And I want to say this. I was reading scripture last night, and I was flipping the pages. And as I flipped the pages, it took me to 1 John 2:9. And everyone, a lot of you are familiar with this. This is the story of the prophet Elijah. And it reminded me so much of that scripture as I read it. As the prophet came into town, a woman opened up her home, and she says, you know, honey, I think this man is a good man. This man is a man of God.
Amen.
You know what? I want to set up him a bed and a table and a candle. And she invited him into her home because she was kind. She was being obedient. She had no humility, but it was her kindness. And in reward of that, she not knowing he a prophet, but she know this man's got something. He got something. She invites him in, and every time he came into this town, he come to her house. He asked her, you know what, you've been so kind to me. And I thank you, Father God. You've been so kind to me, God. Mm. We should be asking, what should I do for you, Father God?
Amen.
As she did, what should Amen. I do for you? She came in and she says, well, you know, I haven't had a baby. He said, you will be pregnant. You will have a child. She gave birth to that boy, to make a long story short, and the story we all know. She gave birth to that boy, but that boy died. She called her servants and she said, get the donkey, come fast. Come fast, because I got to take my baby to Elijah. When she came to Elijah and she began to grab at him, the armor bearer said, huh. He said, no, let her through. Let her through. Let her through. So I'm kind of putting this story together with my bishop. I'm thinking, okay, God said, as he used Elijah, he used my bishop, Chris.
Oh.
He used my bishop, Chris, to come in and intercede. He came in. And as he, now get this story. Now, he was present with that young boy. He laid him hand to hand. He looked eye to eye. And he put that rod over his hair. A few minutes later, he walks out. And he said, go on and see your boy. Let me tell you, my bishop, through the grace of God, did it through a cell phone.
Amen.
He did it through a cell phone. In the name of God.
Amen.
God already knew what he needed to do. Bishop knew what he needed to do.
He already knew.
Thank you, Father.
Oh, Lord Jesus, thank you.
Praise God, friends. We give God all the praise and all the glory. But isn't it so awesome to see that not only does God work across the waters and in third world countries, as we hear so often of marvelous testimonies, but God is working signs and wonders wherever his word is being confirmed. We here at Lifeway Church Ministries of Rancho Cucamonga in Corona, California, give God all of the glory. Give God all of the praise, for his mercy and grace is everlasting to everlasting. We have healing services in Rancho Cucamonga every fourth Sunday of the month, and we have healing services in Corona every third Sunday of the month. Please, if you're ailing in your body, maybe you're dealing with sickness and disease, we would love to pray for you. But even more so, we would love to invite you to Lifeway Church of Rancho Cucamonga or Lifeway Church of Corona, that you would become a part of our ministry and be under the alignment which causes God glory to flourish, because Jesus is the head and he set the church in order as it pleased him. And I believe that it pleases God to have you and your family covered. So friends, till next time, we invite you to continue to be blessed, to continue to be a part of our broadcast. Call us, let us know that this ministry and today's message has been a blessing to you. God bless you.